I'd like to take this opportunity to share with you how the task of designing light fixtures for a contemporary mosque project led us to discover that the mosque lamp is far more than just a functional accessory in the architecture of a mosque. Before moving to Chicago, Nazanin, my wife and I, we were based in Malaysia, and our work was mostly in the architectural field. And one of the projects that we were involved in there was a mosque in the north of the country. Is there any way to partially dim the lights, or is it either on or off? Yeah, I think it may be. Well, try. It gives you a better picture of the projected image, but then that's the main thing. All right, go ahead. As I said, we were involved in a project, a mosque project in the north of Malaysia, Masjid Al-Bukhari in Al-Astar. And initially, our responsibility was to design the domes of the mosque. Nazanin, my wife, did a beautiful design in a style reminiscent of the Persian Safavid-style mosques in Isfahan, with a band of Quranic calligraphy running around the base of the dome, also the interior of the domes, a geometric treatment, but with star-shaped spaces within the geometry, providing spaces for calligraphic inscriptions of the 99 names, the Asma al-Husna. Medium-sized domes also with a geometric style motif on the dome and a frieze of Quranic calligraphy running around the base of the dome, likewise small-sized domes. Beneath the domes, we designed a Mokarnas treatment. And we were also asked for the same project to design and supply a mihrab, which was made with the cooperation of a group of craftsmen in Iran, craftsmen who work for the organization responsible for the preservation of the cultural heritage, the restoration of the historic monuments in Iran. So, in addition to the mihrab, also a minbar. The minbar was made almost as a replica of the minbar in the Qiblatain Mosque in Medina. And as Romana mentioned in the introduction, I was working for the architect who designed the Qiblatain Mosque in Medina, and so it was not by chance that we chose to replicate the design in the project in Al-Astar. In this case, with a more ornate treatment than the minbar in Al-Qiblatain was able to receive for various reasons. So the domes, the mihrab, and the minbar, having completed that part of the work, we took it upon ourselves to make recommendations for how the design of the mosque could be further enhanced. And that's what led us to the idea of introducing light fixtures into the mosque. You'll probably have gathered from looking at the images I've just shown that our approach to design generally involves working with tradition. You may ask yourself why it is that we have a Persian-style dome in a mosque in Kuala Lumpur, and in Malaysia, in the north of Malaysia. The reason for that was actually that the client for that particular project, he was a wealthy philanthropist who was also responsible for establishing the Islamic Arts Museum in Kuala Lumpur, but it was his specific intention to introduce to the community in the region where he lived, who probably were not in a position to travel to different parts of the Islamic world, something of the richness of the Islamic cultural heritage, the architectural heritage. So all of the references for the designs of the different parts of the building, they were in response to various historical precedents, but this was an approach to design which in any case I had inherited from Abdul Wahid al-Wakil, the architect for whom I worked, who really introduced the idea of working in tradition in the footsteps of his mentor, Hassan Fathi, a person who really brought about a revival of traditional architecture. He has this beautiful quotation, "When the full power of a human imagination is backed by the weight of a living tradition, the resulting work of art is far greater than any that an artist can achieve when he has no tradition to work in or when he willfully abandons his tradition." So the whole notion of working with tradition is very central to our approach to design. Nazanin independently somehow arrived at the same conclusion, having already been working as a graphic artist. She went on to do her master's in art research, and here also it's a question of an element of historic research always being an indispensable element in the design process. In a sense, the starting point of any design is to familiarize yourself with examples from the past which can inform and inspire you in contemporary designs. So when it came to embarking on the design of light fixtures for a mosque, the first step in the design process was to undertake a research into the history of the mosque lamp. And this in itself turned out to be a remarkably rich topic and a very rewarding field of study. One discovers, looking at the history of the mosque lamp, that in fact the use of mosque lamps goes back to the time of the Prophet. And indeed has a prophetic endorsement. There is this hadith account. I'll just read the translation for those who can read Arabic. For those who can read Arabic, it's in Arabic above. Tamim Adari brought from Syria to Medina lamps with oil and chains. On Thursday night, his servant Abul Barad hung the lamps in the mosque and put water, oil, and wicks in them. And on Friday, when the Prophet entered the mosque, on seeing the lamps, he addressed Tamim and said, "You have illuminated Islam. May the light of God be upon you in this world and the hereafter." So we see from day one, essentially, the use of lamps in the context of the mosque was praised and endorsed by the Prophet. Further accounts from the early Islamic period include the account of a remarkable lamp which hung above the mihrab of the companions in the Great Mosque of Damascus by the Umayyad Caliph Al-Walid. This legendary crystal lamp, known by the name Qulayla, is described variously as a pearl that shone like a lamp, a pearl which shone with its own light even when the other lamps in the mosque were extinguished, as a precious stone, a crystal stone, or a rock crystal vase. It's evident from these accounts that the lamp itself must have been made from crystal glass. This remarkable lamp had a complex destiny. The Abbasid Caliph Al-Amin, the son of Harun al-Rashid, he was a collector of rock crystal, and he had the lamp secretly transported to Baghdad. The next Abbasid Caliph Al-Ma'mun subsequently returned it to the mihrab of the companions in Damascus. It disappeared again and was subsequently replaced by a glass lamp. But from the early Islamic period, we have accounts of mosque lamps which really went down in history. The accounts that we've just read, it gives a verbal description of the lamp, but it gives us little in the way of an indication of what these lamps would have looked like, the form of the lamps. Archaeologists have attempted to reconstruct early mosque lamps. Logically, due to the fragility of the material, there are few surviving glass lamps from the early period. They break very easily, but this is one example which was recovered from an 11th century shipwreck off the coast of Turkey. One very interesting piece of evidence, so to say, in giving one an impression of how the earliest mosque lamps would have looked is this remarkable Quran manuscript, on the frontispieces of which there's a double spread representing a kind of mosque architecture. And in each one of the arches, one can see a representation of a lamp hanging within the arched form. Just zooming in on a little detail, one can see a round form with a kind of neck on it, some chains supporting the lamp, and within it a container, presumably containing oil, and a flame rising within it. So one has the significant thing about this particular Quran manuscript is that it dates from the first Islamic century, so it gives one a very early graphic representation of how mosque lamps may have looked in that period. There is an example kept in the Aga Khan collection. It's not clear exactly what period this dates from, but it gives one again an idea of how the spherical globular body with this funnel-shaped neck and then points of support around the top of the body. Rock crystal lamps were not used all that commonly due to the rarity of the material. Besides this Qulayla lamp, which was in the Umayyad Mosque in Damascus, there are descriptions of rock crystal lamps in Mecca at the Zamzam Dome. But by the 9th century, mosque lamps were also being made from blown glass. And maybe also from before. It's possible that the description of the lamps brought by Tamim al-Dari from Syria, they may also have been blown glass lamps. There are records of lighting fixtures in Christian sanctuaries dating back to the early pre-Islamic era, where clearly blown glass was also used from sanctuaries in Jerusalem and from the Hagia Sophia Cathedral in Istanbul and in Constantinople at that time. One thing one doesn't always grasp is that these very early glass lamps were actually very small in size. These are two examples in the collection in Iran. One of them is less than 6 inches tall, and the other is just less than 2.5 inches tall. So these were actually tiny, tiny fixtures initially. But by the Mamluk period, the glass craftsmen had mastered the techniques and they were able to produce glass lamps of a much larger size. In the Mamluk period, there are examples 15, 16, 17 inches tall. So one's talking about quite a different order of magnitude here. During the reign of Sultan Hassan, hundreds of these mosque lamps were made by the Sultan and his emirs. They became extremely popular during the reign of the Sultan Qalaun, the Mamluk Sultan Qalaun, and they became known as Qanadil Qalauni, according to one noteworthy detail is that the lamps produced during the Mamluk period tend to be made of a glass which is rather grayish colored and cloudy. It has bubbles and streaks in it because Egypt did not have a supply of pure crystalline glass. And this, nevertheless, indirectly led to the development of the arts of gilding and enameling. because the glass itself lacked a certain kind of clarity, the artists were drawn to ornament the surface of the glass lamps in color with enameling and in gold. A lot of the gold hasn't actually survived from these earlier examples, but one can imagine how the voids would earlier have been filled with a gold color. So this more than compensated for the impurity of the glass. The Mamluk mosque lamps are generally decorated with inscriptions from the Ayat al-Nur on the neck, and dedications to the Sultan or to the patron on the body of the lamp, either with blue script on a gold background and gold script on a blue background in the two areas, or in reverse order, vice versa, sometimes gold on blue and blue on gold. But usually the two options are up and down in reverse order. This is an example which was on display until just recently at the Sackler Gallery in Washington, D.C., in conjunction with this beautiful exhibition of Quran manuscripts. And this one, Mamluk glass lamp, again, it shows the use of the Quranic verse of light, the Ayat al-Nur. Allahu Nur as-samawati wal-ard, mathalu nurihi kamishkatin fiha misbah. Al-misbah. It continues, but it doesn't go any further than that. Maybe the fi zujaj is implicitly, the inscription itself is fi zujaj. Besides glass lamps, one finds early mosque lamps made from a variety of other materials. Many of them were made from metal. Ibn al-Najjar records in 1197 that in the Prophet's tomb in Medina, there were more than 40 silver lamps, two of crystal and one of gold. Ibn Jubayr in 1185 describes the mosque of Qasr Sa'd in Sicily as having 40 lamps of brass and crystal. In the early Islamic era, most lamps would have been executed in brass or copper or bronze, perforated to allow the light to pass. One can see here the multiplicity of small perforations, like a kind of honeycomb, allowing the light to pass, but used in conjunction with calligraphy, which stands out in silhouette against the background of the main perforated areas. Other fragments of early Islamic lamps, which came from excavations in Shahrarai in Iran. One can see the perforations in the metallic lamps use decorative motifs. In the earlier style of lamps, it was most often a geometric style of perforation, a geometric style of decoration. Here one can see a combination of six-pointed stars with hexagonal shapes in between. More complex types of geometric motifs. This is a brass lamp which is allegedly was produced for the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem, kept in the Louvre Museum in Paris. During the Mamluk period, one encounters some remarkably fine examples of mosque lamps. Here the style of ornamentation is tending more towards the biomorphic arabesque. It tends to predominate more than the earlier lamps, which had the geometric style seen in the earlier lamps, but used in combination with calligraphy also in a frieze at around the middle of the body and also on the neck of the lamp. And also one sees in this particular example the support details, this kind of hook detail and a base and a dome at the top. These details are very beautifully executed during the Mamluk period. This is another example, contemporaneous, but in this case lacking its support details and the base and the upper dome. More or less at the same time during the Mamluk period, one sees the emergence of larger, more complex types of mosque lamp. In this type known as the thuraya, there were a number of small glass containers introduced into a tray at the base of the lamp, rather in the style of the earlier polycandelon type light fixture, which goes back much earlier, of course, and in this case in conjunction with a domed top to it. Again, more complex types of lamps. This also will have had a tray at the base with similar kinds of receptacles to contain the glass light fixtures below. But then on a much larger scale, this type of light fixture known as a tanur, literally meaning an oven, but it's on such a large scale that it was known as a tanur. One can see representations of this type of tanur lamp. One gets a sense of the scale, larger than a person really. And small glass receptacles containing the oil and the wicks to provide light. One can imagine that when this larger type of light fixture started to become used, it started to take precedence over the lamps in the form that we saw earlier, which would have contained a single wick. And maybe it's for that reason, here we see other styles of this kind of polycandelon type of light fixture containing a multiplicity of glass containers, on the same kind of thing arranged on tiers one above another here. But what one quite surprisingly, really quite remarkably, starts to encounter is that the mosque lamp form that we saw in the earlier lamps, it continues to be used really up until the latest periods of Islamic history. The same characteristic type of mosque lamp form with the globular base and the funnel-shaped neck continued to be used, but there was this really remarkable phenomenon, and I'll read this quotation from David Rice. He was an art historian at School of Oriental and African Studies in London. The earliest Islamic metal lamps were decorated with pierced overall patterns. In the 13th century, a marked reduction of the pierced surfaces took place. Finally, after the middle of the 14th century, there appeared specimens without any perforation whatever. Metal lamps of the 13th and 14th centuries were fashioned out of thicker sheets of metal. The pierced areas were drastically reduced or completely eliminated. One can see here example from the 13th century. It's a very beautiful example of craftsmanship involving this so-called repoussé work, where the surface of the copper is actually raised in three-dimensional relief with all of these biomorphic Islami decorations covering the surface, but one can see remarkably little perforation in the surface of the body. And indeed, there were examples which were entirely lacking perforation, these two examples dating from the Ottoman period. And when one thinks about it, these fixtures really could not have served functionally as lamps emitting any usable amount of light. The light, if there was a wick inside these lamps, it would have cast light solely in an upwards direction, and particularly in the Ottoman period, the architecture was renowned for having extremely tall spaces with domes, a great height above where the lamps would have been suspended. So normally if this type of thing were hung in a space with a low ceiling, one might expect a certain amount of light to be reflected back from the ceiling, but where the ceilings were so high, it's very hard to imagine how a fixture like this can have produced a usable amount of light at all. Again, in the Ottoman period, one finds a remarkable transition. In the Mamluk period, mosque lamps were made predominantly from glass, but suddenly in the Ottoman period, mosque lamps were made almost exclusively from ceramics. And in the same way as we saw in the previous examples, which were metallic but without any perforation, these light fixtures, so-called, they would have been entirely opaque and could not have transmitted any light through the wall of the body of the lamp. Nevertheless, they were great works of art. One can see from the early 16th century onwards, some of the most famous were made for the Museum of Sultan Bayazid, the so-called blue and white lamps. Highly ornate treatment on the surface of the lamp. What one starts to see, interestingly enough, over the course of the 16th century, a progression from the form of the lamp in the early 16th century. It still retains the roughly spherical globular shaped body with the projecting funnel shaped neck. Towards the middle of the 16th century, the typical cross-sectional shape of the lamp had been changed into this characteristic S-curve here, like a kind of a vase, but moving away from the classical mosque lamp form. But the other very noticeable feature is the use of calligraphy on the surface of the lamps. And of course, the Ottoman period was renowned for the development of calligraphy, the arts of the pen. It was really a period where calligraphy flourished. And so one finds examples where calligraphy is used extensively. In this particular example from the Soleimaniye Mosque in Istanbul, one sees again the verse of light inscribed in a calligraphic form around the neck of the mosque lamp. Allahu Nur As-Samawat Wal-Ard Mathalu Nurihi Kamishkatim Fiha. And the Misbah is just written very small in here, inserted between the letters. Fiha Misbah. What one understands from this is that there is a progression in the development of the mosque lamp which tends more and more away from this type of object being designed as a practical light fixture, more towards it being an object with a symbolic presence and significantly carrying the inscription of the Quranic verse of light. One of the things which struck us most when we started researching the whole history of the mosque lamp, when one starts to read in books about various examples of mosque lamps, I would say the overwhelming majority of examples that you read, the author makes reference to the verse of light in the Quran. You can almost, you can hardly fail to open a book citing the example of a particular mosque lamp, and the author will make mention of the verse of light in the Quran. And of course, there is a very good reason for that. The verse of light in the Quran is a unique example where one is given the symbol of a niche within which is a lamp. This is a symbol of God's light. To understand the significance of the mosque lamp, it's really a question of delving into the inner meanings of the verse of light in the Quran. Because if these objects are primarily designed as reminders pointing to the verse of light in the Quran, it presupposes that one is familiar with the verse of light. If it's going to do any good to be reminded of it, one has to have a basic familiarity for it to serve any use. So, if you'll allow me, I'll just explore a little bit some of the depths of meaning of the Ayat al-Nur in the Quran. It begins with the phrase, God is the light of the heavens and the earth. I've put together a kind of a graphic representation. Of course, in the Quran, the description is given purely in words, but I personally find it helps to have a kind of a visual representation of things to enable one to get a kind of picture in one's mind to see what those words, what image those words will conjure up. So it follows on, God is the light of the heavens and the earth. The symbol of his light is as a niche, a mishka, wherein is a lighted wick. The word misbah in the Quran, it's very often translated as lamp, but it's specifically the element which produces light, the luminary. It's somehow incorrect to translate it as a lamp because that could conjure up a different image. But within the mishka is a misbah, a lighted wick. The wick is in a glass, and this glass is, as it were, a radiant star. Kindled from a blessed olive tree, neither of the east nor of the west, whose oil would all but glow, though fire touch it not. Light upon light, God guideth to his light whom he will, and God citeth symbols for men, and God is the knower of all things. So we have in the Quranic description a symbol which is composed of a number of different elements. The niche, the mishka, the wick, the misbah, contained within a glass and fueled by the oil of the olive. The Quran tells us that besides verses with clear dogmatic meanings, ayat muhkamat, it contains verses which have an allegorical meaning, ayat mutashabihat. Particularly in the allegorical verses, the imagery is initially seen to relate to the outer world, but the interpretation of the verses reveals meanings relating to the inner or microcosmic plane. In the Quranic verse of light, the word mathal is used. Mathalu nurihi. It specifically says an example, a symbol of his light is as a niche wherein there is a misbah. And the verse concludes with the statement, وَيَضْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ, and God citeth symbols for men, and God is the knower of all things. So it's clear that we are dealing here with one of these allegorical verses. The Quran frequently employs symbolic allegories, amthal, a variety of Quranic quotations. Verily, we have coined for mankind in this Quran all kinds of similitudes, and God coineth similitudes for men that they may remember. As for these similitudes, we coin them for mankind, but none will grasp their meanings except the wise. To grasp the meanings of these allegorical verses involves interpretation, or what in Arabic is known as tafsir. And since the early Islamic times, many works of tafsir have been written by Quranic commentators. And undoubtedly the most famous of these is the Mishkat al-Anwar of Abu Hamid Muhammad al-Ghazali. The Mishkat al-Anwar. In this, al-Ghazali discusses the significance of light, comparing what he describes as various grades of light. He contrasts physical light with the eye, which is that which makes things visible, and he finds that the eye is therefore more worthy of the term light. But then, by listing seven defects related to the physical eye, he sees that intelligence is more properly called light, because it transcends the defects of the eye. Then he considers the role of divine revelation in enabling the intelligence to see actually rather than just potentially. And therefore, it is the Quran that is most properly called light. But he concludes that these degrees of light rise to what he calls a final fountainhead who is light in and by himself. And that Allah alone is the true light, and beside him there is no light at all. So as we have seen, the symbol in the verse of light, it's relatively complex. It's comprised of the diverse elements that we have seen, the light itself, the niche, the wick, the glass, and the oil. Al-Ghazali gives an explanation, gives an interpretation of the meaning of these elements, the niche, the lamp, the glass, the tree, and the oil, and demonstrates their relationship to the five faculties of the human soul, what he describes as the sensory spirit, the imaginative spirit, the intelligential spirit, the discursive spirit, and the transcendental prophetic spirit. And he concludes by saying these lights of the human spirit are graded rank upon rank, light upon light. This building on the phrase in the verse of light, nurun ala nur, light upon light. But Al-Ghazali's interpretation, his tafsir on the ayat al-Nur, is by no means the only interpretation given. And in fact, many, many interpretations have been given by commentators over the ages. And Guénon, who writes extensively on symbolism, he speaks of the harmonious multiplicity of meanings which are included in all symbolism, and also says that every real symbol bears multiple meanings within itself. So it's entirely to be expected that there is not just one single interpretation of the ayat al-Nur, in the same way that one speaks of the Holy Quran as having multiple levels of meaning. It's not that one of these levels is correct and all of the others are false. Each one of them is correct in its own way, and sacred texts lend themselves to interpretation. It's interesting to dwell on the significance of light itself. Within the Islamic context, An-Nur is one of the 99 divine names in the Quran, one of the Asma al-Husna, the beautiful names. And there is this beautiful account from the Mi'raj of the Prophet when he rose through the seven heavens. When the Prophet was asked if he had seen God when he journeyed to him in his ascent, he replied, "He is a light. He is a light. How could I see him?" So we have this description of God as perceived as in the form of light. Needless to say, representations like this in illuminated manuscripts, an artist is challenged to present such realities in graphic terms, but it can again help to give a picture to the words that are given here. He is a light, how could I see him? The verse of light tells us that God is the light of the heavens and the earth. We have here a clear description of God in heaven as light, but the question is, how does this light actually enter the terrestrial plane? How is God the light of the earth? Light features prominently in the biblical account of creation. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light. And there was light, and God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. There isn't an exact equivalent of this account in the Quran, but there are numerous hadith traditions where one sees that light also plays an extremely important role in the Islamic doctrines relating to creation and cosmic manifestation. A hadith states, Jabir ibn Abdullah, one of the companions, asked the Prophet, O Messenger of Allah, tell me of the first thing Allah created before all things. And he said, O Jabir, the first thing Allah created was the light of your Prophet from his light, and that light remained in the midst of his power for as long as he wished, and there was not at that time a tablet or a pen or a paradise or a fire or an angel or a heaven or an earth or a moon, a sun or a moon or jinn or man. And when Allah wished to create creation, he divided that light into four parts, and from the first made the pen, from the second the tablet, from the third the throne. Then he divided the fourth into four parts, and from them created everything else. But one can see here in this account how essentially everything is created from the divine light. The light of Muhammad, the Nur Muhammadi, is an important concept in Islamic cosmology, according to which the whole cosmos emanates from this light. This doctrine is supported by a hadith in which the Prophet states, I am made of God's light, and all created beings are made of my light. Another hadith states, Allah created his creation in darkness, then on the same day he sent his light upon them. Whoever was touched by his light on that day will be guided, and whoever was missed will be led astray. The Quran frequently uses the expression from the darkness to the light, min al-zulumati ilan-nur, as a metaphor for divine guidance. The verse of light ends with the message that God guides to his light whom he will. Light is metaphorically associated with guidance, from ignorance to illumination. Divine light is equated with the guidance offered by the sacred revealed scripture, and by extension with the Prophet, who conveys guidance, and who in the Quran is referred to explicitly as a source of light, Sirajam Munira. In the image at the bottom of the screen here, one can see an extract from a manuscript of the Dala'il al-Khairat, in which the Prophet Muhammad is referred to by a variety of noble names, Nur, Siraj, Misbah, and then Huda. Guidance is evidently directly related to the light and his light-giving function. And numerous accounts of the Prophet associate apparitions of light with his person. Hadith states that wherever he went in darkness, he had light shining around him like the moonlight. And similarly, in representations in illuminated manuscripts, one often finds the person of the Prophet surrounded by an aura of light. We have here the verse of the light, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, inna arsalna shahidan wa mubashiran wa nazira wa da'an ilallahi bi'idhnihi wa sirajan munira. On a more individual level, the question of how the divine life, the divine light makes itself manifest in the world. One possible interpretation of the verse of light, the Ayat-ul-Nur, is the following. The niche is understood to be a metaphor for the body. The flame, or the spark of life within it, is the spirit. The spirit is that which gives us life. Light is that which makes things manifest, but what actually makes us manifest is that spark of life which God has breathed into every living thing. It is that which actually makes one manifest. In fact, the Ishraqi school of Islamic philosophy equates light with being. Without that spark of life, none of us would be at all. So it is that divine spark within all of us which has caused us to be manifest. So within the niche representing the body is contained the flame of the spirit, which resides in the heart, the seat of our innermost consciousness. And the heart is represented by the glass, which is radiant like a star. The element that feeds the flame of the spirit is the soul, represented by the oil. It's somehow the function of the soul to keep the flame of the spirit alive. The spirit is evidently luminous, but the soul is also luminous when purified, and even before it's ignited by the flame of the spirit. I'd like to say a few points about this element, the Mishka. In all of the ways in which we have translated this word until now, Mishka has been taken to mean a niche, but it's مَثَلُ نُورِهِ كَمِشْكَاتٍ فِيهَا مِسْبَاحٍ. The symbol of his light is a mishka, wherein there is a misbah. What is interesting to note is that there are many different interpretations about the original meaning of the word mishka. And there's a great debate amongst linguists going back many centuries, and a particular reading of the meaning of the word Mishka is actually the perforated body surrounding the lamp. And particularly in the Persian world, Mishka, Mishkat, is the name to this day still used to designate this type of perforated metallic light fixture. If one talks about a Mishkat, people will automatically understand you to be referring to just such a feature. And evidently such a feature can also contain a glass with holding oil and a wick burning within here. And it doesn't essentially alter the symbolism of what we've been discussing until now, that the Mishka can be taken to refer to something of this kind. In fact, a number of the Quran commentaries on the Ayat-ul-Nur from authorities in the Persian world, Sheikh Mahmoud Shabistari and Safi Ali Shah, in their discussion of the meaning of the verse of light, when they talk about the Mishka, they talk about the way in which the light shines through the perforations. And clearly this is not a reference to the kind of niche that we have been talking about until now. For them, the Mishka represents this type of perforated lamp body. But be that as it may, for the majority of commentaries, people take the Mishka to refer to this kind of a niche. When we talk of a niche, this is generally the kind of image that this conjures up, a recess in a wall surface. It's interesting how Before there were temples, religious rites took place in caves, and many authors comment on the significance of this. The first revelation of the Quran came to the Prophet in a cave on the Jabal al-Nur. The name of the mountain is in itself significant, the mountain of light, the Jabal al-Nur. And symbolically, the niche is the equivalent of the cave. This is evident in the case of the Islamic revelation, but one finds striking similarities in many other traditions. It's said that Moses, in the Bible, it's written that Moses waited in a cave at the summit of Mount Sinai before he received the Ten Commandments. This is actually a depiction of the prophet Elijah, who returned to the same cave at the summit of Mount Horeb. There are also certain Christian traditions describing the nativity of Jesus in a cave. In fact, the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem is built over a cave. The book of the Apocalypse was revealed to St. John in a cave on the island of Patmos. The tale of the seven sleepers is recounted in both Christian traditions and in the Quran, giving the Surat al-Kahf its name. And the cave, one can say, is analogous to the womb of Mother Earth. It's universally associated with birth and regeneration. Titus Burckhardt writes, "The sacred niche derives from a worldwide symbolism, and this symbolism is implicitly confirmed by the Quran. The niche is a consistent image of the cave of the world, the place of appearance of the divinity, the mazhar, whether it be a case of the outward world as a whole or the inner world, the sacred cave of the heart." All Oriental traditions recognize the significance of this. Where Burckhardt here talks about the equivalence of the sacred cave of the heart, one can likewise imagine on a personal level that the cave is the place where revelation took place. The divine spirit manifested itself in terms of the sacred scriptures and in other forms. But on a personal level, where we individually seek for inspiration, we spontaneously retreat into an inner space. We can close our eyes, and if we are seeking inspiration, we shut ourselves off from the outside world and retreat, symbolically, one can say, into a space equivalent to the cave that we have seen described here. And if one is lucky, one is blessed with inspiration. But this is Burckhardt continues, "To establish the symbolism of the mihrab in its Islamic perspective, it must be related to its Quranic context. The word literally means refuge. The Quran in particular uses this word to describe a secret place in the temple at Jerusalem where the Holy Virgin entered into a spiritual retreat and was nourished by angels. The inscriptions around the arch of the mihrab are frequently such as to recall the Quranic story in question." Very commonly in mihrabs, particularly in the Turkish world, but elsewhere, one finds an inscription taken from the so-called verse of the mihrab in the Quran, "Kullama dakhala alayha Zakariya al-mihrab," every time Zacharias entered in unto her in the mihrab, it continues, he found her with sustenance, with divine sustenance. So there is this notion that entering into the niche, into the sacred space, one will be rewarded with divine sustenance. Again, the quotation continues, "The form of the mihrab, discounting its name, calls to mind another passage from the Quran, the verse of light, where the divine presence in the world or in the heart of man is compared to a light from a lamp placed in a niche. The analogy between the mihrab and the mishka is clear. It is emphasized, moreover, by hanging a lamp before the prayer niche. There are two distinct words used in the Quran. The word in the verse of light is the mishka, and the mihrab is, it's not the same word that's used, but there are evident parallels that essentially one is talking about one and the same thing. And this is further borne out by the fact that the two verses in the Quran in question, the verse of the mihrab and the verse of the light, both of them culminate in the same message that God provides to whom he will sustenance beyond all reckoning. The significance of the verse of light in Islamic culture is such that one frequently finds it inscribed in architecture. One sees here a beautiful mihrab from the Safavid period made in Isfahan in Iran in the 17th century. And the whole mihrab is surrounded by an inscription of the verse of light, Allahu Nur Samawat wal Ard, in its entirety. A much earlier mihrab dating from the Seljuk period, 12th century in Qazvin in Iran, also has the entire verse of light inscribed in the stucco ornamentation surrounding the mihrab. In the Ottoman period, not on the mihrab itself, but in the stained glass windows immediately above the mihrab in the Soleimaniye Mosque in Istanbul, one finds the verse of light inscribed in the stained glass. Further examples from Istanbul: at the very apex of this majestic dome, one has the verse of light inscribed, really shining down on the whole space like the divine light. One finds early examples from the 11th to 12th century, where the verse of light is inscribed in the decorative brickwork on a minaret in Iran, in Damghan. In Egypt, the arches around the inner courtyard of the Al-Aqmar Mosque in Cairo, one has an inscription, Allahu Nur Samawati wal Ard, you can possibly make it out here. It continues in its entirety around the adjacent arches. The same mosque in Cairo, we're looking here at the external facade facing the street. There is a frieze of Quranic calligraphy running across the facade here, which is also from the Surat-al-Nur, not actually from the Ayat-al-Nur. But what is particularly significant about this facade, it's not so much the calligraphy as a small detail in the upper left-hand corner. And here one finds a graphic representation of a mosque lamp within an arched form here. And this is one of the earliest examples of such a thing, but we will go on to see now how the mosque lamp was actually used as a decorative motif in ornamentation in Islamic architecture and other objects in Islamic culture. Prayer rugs very commonly feature an arched form surrounding a lamp motif hanging within the arch. This is another example of a prayer rug, the so-called soft type from the Selimiyye Mosque in Edirne. This is one of the earliest examples, architectural examples, where one finds a series of mosque lamps painted in the stucco on the interior wall surfaces of a tomb tower in Kharakan, Iran, dating from the Seljuk period. In Iran, from somewhat later dates, One finds mosque lamp motifs used extensively in objects with a funerary connection, tomb markers or such things. This and the next are examples of beautiful glazed fritware produced in the workshops in Kashan, where they mastered the art of producing remarkably large pieces of ceramics molded in three dimensions and glazed very often using the luster technique, which had a kind of a shining kind of almost metallic surface to it. Again, in a funerary context, one sees this carved in stone, an example from Mamluk Egypt. One sees the lamp hanging within the arched form, in this case also flanked by two candlesticks at the base. And across the center of the circular body of the lamp, one again finds an inscription of the Allahu Nur as-Samawati wal-Ard, the opening line of the verse of light. Again, as a tomb marker, one sees a cenotaph produced in the 15th century. The workshops in Gujarat, in Khambat in Gujarat, they produced a large number of marble carvings, both tomb markers and also mihrabs, which were in fact exported around the Indian Ocean from East Africa as far as Indonesia. And almost invariably they involved the use of this lamp motif. And so in India, again on a mihrab, one finds the lamp within the arch as a motif. The idea that the lamp is a symbol of the divine is very directly borne out here by the inscription of the divine name within the body of the lamp here. It's clearly drawing attention to the fact that the lamp is a symbol of the divine. In Bengal, one finds in the Adina Mosque, it's an example where the lamp motif is really the light motif, no pun intended, light in the German sense of the mosque lamp motif really is used extremely extensively in numerous mihrabs and on the wall surfaces inside and outside the mosque. Also in Bengal, a lamp motif within a mihrab niche. In Turkey, a lamp motif within this beautiful ceramic treatment on a mihrab niche in the Yeşil Türbe in Bursa. Damascus, again in ceramics, a lamp motif within an arched form in the mosque, which contains the sandals of the Prophet. In Bengal, again, one can see an example here. The lamp motif is highly stylized, but what this example indicates is how the lamp motif entirely dominates the decoration of the mosque as a whole. The whole facade of the mosque is covered in these a representation of the lamp within the niche. And so this brings us to the conclusion that in the same way that we saw in the historical development of the mosque lamp itself, a tendency more and more towards the mosque lamp, its presence in the mosque actually acting as a symbol, as a symbolic reminder of the message contained in the Quranic verse of light. In these examples here, where the mosque lamp is used as a symbol in the architectural decoration, here its function is entirely symbolic. And what one really concludes is that in the case of the lamp itself, one is combining a functional requirement with a symbolic function. Really, essentially, the mosque lamp takes on a predominantly symbolic function in the architecture, the art and architecture of Islam. So, to bring us to a conclusion, I must apologize if I've overshot the time, but to bring us back to our original task, to design a lamp for this mosque in Malaysia, we found the greatest source of inspiration were the metallic lamps dating from the Mamluk period, the perforated brass lamps from the Mamluk period. The lamp that we designed that has the characteristic globular body with the funnel-shaped neck, with a dome and a base, and then these suspension elements. The perforated globular body of the lamp and the funnel-shaped neck, both of them have ornament combining the three essential elements of Islamic art, calligraphy, the geometric, and the biomorphic arabesque. The essential element, of course, is that the calligraphy should include the verse from the Ayat al-Nur, and here we found an example produced by a calligrapher in Turkey in the Thuluth style, Allahu Nur al-Samawat wal-Ard, and in the upper portion of the lamp on the neck, calligraphy from the Ayatun of Nurun ala Nur, combined with biomorphic Islami arabesque and geometric. One can see the 12-sided body of the lamp. It's made in segments and coming together. It has a foot detail. And also on 3 points, there is a rosette-shaped detail which enables the suspension details to connect. The suspension details, like in the Mamluk examples that we saw before, a hook which interconnects with the rosette, a cartouche-shaped element containing the biomorphic Islami ornament, and an eight-pointed star motif in more or less a geometric style at the top. These three suspension elements. The base of the lamp, designed following again examples from the Mamluk period with a kind of simplified mokarnas detail at the base, a dome with a scalloped profile at the top, cast in brass and finished by hand. And one sees here the final lamp, how it turned out. The top and the bottom have an ornament which radiates towards the center and from the center outwards. All of the silver-colored inlay is in fact executed in pewter, a material which Malaysia is famous for. And so the essential element, of course, is that the lamp should act as a reminder of the verse of light. And that brings me to a close.
Thank you very much for the wonderful talk. If anyone has any questions.
Thank you.
I think I have quite plenty of loud enough voice. it's a bit hard to understand the perforated lamp, whether in the Mamluk times or in this one. Of course, you're in the era of electricity. You hang a bulb in there and you get the effect. But the perforated lamp presumably still had a glass bowl in it. I mean, you still need a container for the water, because it's not just pure oil, and then the layer of oil on top with the floating wick, right?
Exactly, that's right.
So there would have been
a glass container, particularly in the case of the metallic lamps with a perforated body. Of course, they could not have contained oil or water,
right.
And but that's entirely in keeping with the imagery in the verse of light that. If one takes the mishkat to be referring to the perforated metallic outer body, within it, it's contained the wick within a glass, holding the oil from which it's kindled. So it's entirely
It wasn't entirely clear from what we saw. There would be light in it, but now it is.
Yes, one thing I was unable to see from reference to surviving examples, which one can find in museums and various other places, is to see one of these traditional lamps complete with all of its functional accessories. I've never actually found the accompanying glass receptacle that inevitably must have gone together with a perforated lamp body like this. And it's surprising in a way, because one has to bear in mind that electricity has been with us really for less than a century, and it's hard to imagine that there isn't a single surviving example still based on the oil lamp. Yeah. But until now, I've been unable to find an example. But if anybody can refer me to one, I'd be very pleased.
No question over here.
Professor, thank you for your enlightening lecture. I have two questions.
Please.
Well, the first one refers to the examples you provided in the Ottoman times. The images you provided us, and you also stated, were ones that were solid. There was no perforations. That means they weren't translucent.
That's
so correct. Should we assume that they were symbolic in their nature?
Exactly. Actually, I have to say, I pondered this question for a long time when we embarked on this study of the history of the mosque lamp. I went as far as to writing to an eminent historian specialized in Islamic arts and asking her how these lamps could have functioned. And I never actually got an answer back from her, but I mean, it dawned on me that in reality, these cannot have been functional lamps. And in fact, in some books, one finds them referred to as hanging ornaments in the form of a mosque lamp. But the vast majority of books actually describe them as mosque lamps. So, but I think, and on that note, there is a whole tradition of hanging ornaments which were suspended in shrines, both Islamic and Christian, and in various traditions, not all of them in the form of lamps, some of them more spherical in the form of egg shape. There are actual ostrich eggs suspended, and it may have fallen into this pattern, this overall tradition of actually having hanging ornaments suspended in sanctuaries and places of worship. But indeed, as you point out, these can logically just not have cast any useful amount of light.
Which brings me to my second question, please. Which is, if these masjids couldn't obtain light from the lamps that they had, where did the light come from? And the contemporary ones that you designed, they look extremely beautiful. And I'm wondering now, I haven't seen lamps, this was obviously designed from Malaysia, if I'm not mistaken.
That's correct. Yes.
What about, you know, the other Muslim lands, and obviously the lands where, you know, we don't have majority Muslims, but I haven't seen them in contemporary design very much. And I'm just wondering, is there a place for architects who design masjids to include them in their design? And have you been approached by other communities and designers who would integrate that into contemporary mosques? Thank you.
Well, as I understand it, there are two halves to your question. The one is historically, how it was that the lamp moved away towards this type of non-functional fixture. And as I think I hinted at when we started looking at the examples of these larger types of light fixtures, clearly the emergence of these larger types of light fixtures, they would have done the job of providing light within the mosque. But the interesting thing is the qandil, that's the name of this type of lamp with the glob, the spherical shaped body and the neck. It's generally referred to as a qandil. It's not actually a word which is encountered in the Quran, but this early hadith account of Tamim ad-Dari bringing the lamps from Syria to Medina, it uses actually the term qandil, so this term actually does go back to the early Islamic era, to the time of the Prophet. But the Qandil type form remained in use until the latest period, until the Ottoman period. But I presume that it tended more and more in the direction of being used in its symbolic function, due to the fact that the actual job of providing light in the mosque was taken care of by these larger types of light fixtures. And we saw examples of the kind of brass lamp you found in the Mamluk period, and the examples in the mosque in Kairouan and so forth. But in Ottoman Turkey, there was also this style of light fixture of huge metallic frames supported by chains or cables. Of course, one had very tall ceilings there. These domed spaces were very tall, but the light fixtures were designed to hang just a short distance above head height, just almost within reach. And but then one had a myriad of small glass receptacles and many, many small light fixtures. Small glass lamps originally would have contained oil and a wick, but now, of course, has been replaced by electric light bulbs. But historically, I think that's answering the first part of your question, how it is that the Qandil would have been then superseded by other types of light fixture, but never actually driven out of use, because it remained in use, but I think its use continued by virtue of its symbolic significance. And I think one identifies the form described in the Ayat al-Nur as really corresponding to the Qandil type. It's clearly not a more complex type of lamp that's described with a single wick. The question about what is now the norm in contemporary mosques, one generally finds in larger mosques in Arabia, if one goes to Mecca or Medina, there are usually more complex types of light fixture, which are more of this kind of polycandelon type, a brass framework suspending a large number of small lights. Not many of them make an attempt to follow traditional forms. I mean, in a sense, certain traditional elements have been retained, but it was our specific intention to produce a design which made direct reference to historical examples and somehow to try to revive a traditional form. And that's generally what we try to do in our work.
Have you seen one in the West, like in America? Have you seen this in any masjid?
No, I cannot say that I have. I'm not sure that I have.
Do you have a question?
Please go.
Is there somebody else who wants to?
There are two people with that.
Oh, go ahead.
But, I think we'll get to your question after this. Oh, ladies first.
Could I?
Yes, please.
Okay. You mentioned Hassan Fatih.
Indeed.
And he built a mosque in New Mexico. I can't think right now of the name of the place, but I'm sure.
In Dar al-Islam, that's right.
Correct. Yes. What kind of light fixtures does it have, since it's in the United States and it is built by a traditionalist? Well, he was not really a traditionalist. He used old techniques in order to produce things that are in our time, I feel.
He was a traditionalist, if ever there was one, but I think the interpretation of what is meant by a traditionalist is entirely that one should be able to perpetuate a tradition in the contemporary context. It's a living tradition.
Right, right.
It's not a tradition of the past.
That's how it keeps alive.
Indeed. No, in answer to your question, I've visited the mosque in New Mexico in Abiquiu, but I have to say it was many years ago, and I can't specifically remember the type of light fixture. But I do know that his protege, or Abdul Wahid al-Wakil, one for whom I worked for close to 7 years, in many of the mosques that he built, and he was very blessed with the opportunity to construct many mosques in Arabia, reconstructing many of the historic mosques in Medina, Al-Quba Mosque, Al-Qiblatain Mosque, Al-Miqat, in Jeddah, many other mosques besides. In all of his projects, he will have incorporated designs which specifically make an attempt to follow tradition. And I was blessed to be involved in quite a number of these projects, so I'm speaking from first-hand experience.
We have a question over here.
Please, sir.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
Thank you very much for illuminating us, as somebody said, enlightening us. Really enjoyed your talk, and especially the contribution that you have made. One question that occurred to me was that these so-called opaque lamps were open to the top.
Correct.
And so you would have a halo of light exiting from that opening, I would think.
Well, for you to
directed upwards,
to be able to see that light, either you would have to have a surface, a wall surface or a ceiling surface to actually see the light projected onto, or conceivably if the atmosphere was very humid or very cloudy, you would see a halo of, you would see the light actually cast onto the atmosphere. But as I pointed out, in spaces where the ceilings were renowned for being tall, it's very, particularly in the Ottoman period, where one has these vastly tall domed spaces, it's impossible to imagine that the light would have shone on the dome and reflected back down, the light from a single wick, like a burning a single candle. It's inconceivable, really.
And yet they did burn those wicks in those lamps, in those opaque lamps.
Well, again, I can't be sure if they did even actually light a wick in them, or whether they just hung there symbolically. I wouldn't be able to say for sure. I mean, maybe one could find some examples and find some soot residing on the interior of the lamp, but I wouldn't be able to say for sure.
I heard from history. I read research sources that the architect Sinan, who built the Suleimaniye Mosque,
yes,
he built the mosque in a way that when the candles, the candles burned, the dark smoke would rise so that it would come to one point and then would collect there, so that the walls would not go, would not keep the stain and it wouldn't go dark.
Mm-hmm.
So they used those candles, but he built the structure in a way that,
right,
that's, doesn't affect the calligraphy on the walls. It doesn't turn to dark, and then,
right,
somehow it's been a miraculous.
I understand. Yes, I wasn't aware of that that account, but it's possible that that refers to the light that was lit in these other types of these very large light fixtures that one sees in the Ottoman mosques, where one has these huge wheels of metallic wheels suspending these small glass light fixtures. What is really remarkable is that given the size of these light fixtures, they are really very unobtrusive in the space. One has this great spider's web network of chains hanging them, but they really don't obstruct the space. I mean, they're so filigree in their detail that they just very minimally serve their function, actually.
I have a question over here.
Yes.
Hi there. I just want to say I'm really impressed, extremely, extremely impressed. So you mentioned, and I'm going to quote you, you didn't say this part, but in order to make such magnificent pieces, you must have vision. And then you said that someone else had said that there are 7 defects of eyes, and that divine revelation is intelligence, which in turn is light, correct? Something along those lines.
That's right. That's kind of paraphrasing Al-Ghazali's, or condensing Al-Ghazali's interpretation of the verse of light in the Mishkat HaMenorah.
So my question is it safe to assume that the individuals who create these glass lamps have to complete a special form of schooling? And if so, do they have to recite any surahs in the process of creating these lamps?
Well, your question is, I don't know if it's directly connected to your first comment, which is, it's a pertinent comment in its own right, but it is known that the traditional crafts were all performed within the framework of what is the equivalent of a guild system, and the craftsmen were all thoroughly aware of the spiritual significance of the work that they were performing. There was a ritual preparation for the work that they did in terms of purification and possibly fasting and prayer before they will have embarked upon a significant piece of work. And yes, this is known that the crafts, until today, one goes to parts of the world where the traditional crafts have survived in the Islamic world, and one sees the crafts going in processions through the street to the sanctuary at the center of the town in Morocco, procession to the shrine of Mullah Idris at the center of Fez, and in Cairo as well, one sees the crafts coming out, manifesting themselves as a kind of spiritual brotherhood. And clearly that's the way things functioned in the past. To what extent it still does now, I wouldn't be able to say, but it's something that one can aspire to, maybe.
We have a question over here.
I'm an architect myself, so you'll understand where I'm coming from. The contemporary mosques that we see, some of them or a lot of them try to hang larger and larger chandeliers, if I can use that term, right, under the dome, kind of confusing the effect of the dome as well as the chandelier itself sometimes.
True.
Do you, in your research, see evidences of larger implementation of what is a singular object that you, in your creation or design that you've done, other than just additive of this singular? Because when you start adding these in a row or a ring, it becomes a little different than the symbolic effect of these in a niche or in an arch.
I see what you're saying. I think undeniably one can see that historically somehow architects and engineers have been driven by a desire to create larger spaces and larger devices in terms of building a dome with a clear span. You know, there's been, it's a kind of a challenge that architects have been motivated by, and one can clearly see the same thing in the development of more complex types of lamps. But it doesn't mean to say that it's the only way to go forward. One can see how one visits historic mosques in Cairo, for example, and one sees large numbers of these glass hanging lamps, this candle type lamp, hanging in rows, and they also achieve their function, and they're also very beautiful. The other observation that I would make is generally, speaking to an architect, I think generally in the contemporary context, people go a little too far in defining the necessary specification for lighting levels in places of worship. From my experience, you're given the job to design a mosque, and they say that it has to have 300 lux everywhere, with a view to the aim that at any point in the mosque, a person should be able to sit and read the Quran. But in actual fact, if one looks at the practical functionality of what people do when they go to a mosque, reading the Quran is one of a variety of things. And in fact, if one thinks to oneself, what are the spaces that I most like to pray in? Personally, I mean, speaking for myself personally, I prefer to be in a space which doesn't feel like, you know, you know, high levels of lighting beaming down on you. And in order to satisfy the requirement for people to be able to read Quran, it seems quite sufficient to me to have certain parts of the mosque where slightly higher levels of light are provided, and if a person wants to sit to read the Quran, he can find a place where there is sufficient light to read. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the whole mosque has to be illuminated to that level. And one finds this kind of idea expressed in the traditional Ottoman mosques, where, as a kind of feature of the mosque, one finds in the perimeter walls of the mosque window openings, very often looking out onto a landscaped space outside, in contrast to the kind of model you find in the Arab Medina, where the mosque is kind of built in on all sides around it, and the only it's open to an internal courtyard. Very often the Turkish mosques are actually surrounded by an open space, a garden where one can actually look out from the mosque onto greenery, onto trees, and these window openings, a little kind of alcove around the window, very naturally provides a space where people go to sit to read Quran. And I mean, I've seen this many times myself, and it's actually, you know, it's a very nice place to sit to read the Quran. It's more intimate rather than being out in the middle of this great expanse. I mean, the same kind of argument applies to this tendency, this desire of architects to build spaces without any columns in them, this kind of dome with huge open spaces. You know, I naturally gravitate to want to actually be next to a column, either to lean on it or to pray in front of it. Or, I mean, I don't find the column in itself as being a disturbing element. And, you know, history points out, you know, demonstrates that there are so many beautiful mosque designs with a multiplicity of columns, and they really don't disturb the design. They enhance it, so far as I'm concerned. So I think modern architects and engineers are very often driven by this desire for this kind of unwritten law that bigger is better and whatever, but it's not always the case.
Thank you.
But the Spanish mosques seem to have a forest of pillars.
Exactly. In all of the early Islamic centuries, the hypostyle hall was the model for the type of mosque where one has a multiplicity of columns supporting arches, supporting a different type of roof structure. But, you know, to have, you know, it's almost as if the columns themselves are echoing the rows of the congregation standing in prayer. Why not?
Well, we are about out of time, but we do have one question here.
Sorry, you mentioned briefly that lights were like kind of symbolic of tombs and everything. Can you go deeper into that?
Well, it's also it's a good question. Thank you. Yes. Certain authors have also commented on a specific kind of symbolism which relates to the use of the imagery of the mosque lamp in relation to tombs. And it's there's a traditional prayer where one prays for God's light to shine on the tomb of the person who is buried there, and one prays for the light. And in a sense, the use of the mosque lamp in that funerary context, it has a slightly different connotation, but of course it's ultimately one and the same thing, you know, referring to the meaning of God's light. The lamp always symbolically represents a divine presence or a spiritual presence.
So basically for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide your way to heaven, basically, right?
Exactly.
So, like,
that's very, very nicely put, yes. Thank you.
Thank you all for your questions, and thank you so much, Nicholas, for the insightful and illuminating talk.
Thank you.
I would now like to invite President Dawood Kayswit to present to you a token of our appreciation.
Thank you very much.